I did. I went to eat and then I came back.
Went to work?
Eat.
Oh, ma'am, I thought you had been here for a couple weeks.
Oh, yes. Well, thank you for noticing my absence. I appreciate that. I had to figure out something to do to make some money. I had to go to work. I've got some investment properties I needed to do some work.
Oh.
Yeah. Kind of like what you were describing in your work session this afternoon. Needed a lot of work.
It's easier to do. Hey,
Ryan.
How are you?
I'm a little late giving you the information you'd asked me for to college.
What's all that?
At least every 2 years. So here we are, we're going beyond. So, but when the person that's just trying to be chairman.
My apologies, board.
To bring the February 26, 2013 Planning Commission meeting to order. Would everyone please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge of Allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I would like to welcome Troop 317 to our meeting. I'm sure you're probably working on badges. My son did this many years ago, as did, I think, some of our other members' sons. So welcome. Teresa, could you please review the meeting procedures?
Welcome to the Forsyth County Planning Commission meeting. We would like to take a few minutes to cover the procedures of the meeting for those of you that are not familiar with them. For all public hearings, the Planning Commission will allot 10 minutes per side, not 10 minutes per speaker. Please only request to speak if you have something new to add. Please refrain from disrupting this meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments, and please be courteous of others with the use of cell phones. The public is reminded that addressing the Planning Commission or the Board of Commissioners directly is not allowed. All comments shall be directed to the application being heard by the courts. Anyone wishing to productively contribute is welcome to speak during the respective public hearing. And anyone speaking at the public hearing is required to complete a public hearing sign-in sheet and shall give the public hearing sign-in sheet to the staff before approaching the podium. These sheets are available as you enter the meeting room or from our staff. And at the podium, please state your name. All information submitted by the applicant.
Teresa, could you hold off for just a moment? Jody, are you going to join our meeting? It's kind of distracting. All right. Go ahead, Teresa.
All information submitted by the applicant or opposition shall be presented to the staff, not tendered directly to the Planning Commission members. Information shall then be distributed to board members with one copy retained by the Department of Planning and Community Development as part of the permanent record. Department of Planning and Community Development is open Monday through Friday from 8:30 until 5 o'clock. And additional information on cases heard tonight can be found on the Forsyth County website. And the recommendations of this meeting will be heard at the Board of Commissioners meeting on March 21st, 2013.
Thank you, Teresa. Is there a motion to consider adoption of minutes for the January 22nd, 2013 regular meeting and February 19th, 2013 work session?
So moved.
Second for discussion. Can I see the minutes?
Teresa, do you have a copy of the minutes? I know they were emailed.
Somebody told me we didn't have any minutes. Do we have any minutes for the 19th?
I have a copy at home.
We just don't have copies.
We don't have copies here. We got copies emailed to us.
Okay. So somebody told me we didn't have any.
I never received on the 25th.
Yeah, I got a copy. But I just want to see it again before I put on.
Did you receive your email? I emailed it.
I did, and okay. I read it, but I just want to take a look at it again before I put it on.
They're downstairs. They're on a network drive we don't have access to from this computer.
Can we postpone approving the minutes of the February the 19th work session?
If you'd like to make a motion to amend the agenda to change the order, that would be appropriate.
I so move.
Where would you like to put it? Where would you like to put the...
Oh, next month, next regular meeting.
Okay.
There has been a motion to postpone the February 19, 2013 work session consideration for adoption of minutes to our next work session or to the
next regular meeting.
To our next regular meeting. We have a motion. Do we have a second? Motion dies. So we will go back to our original motion to consider adoption of the minutes for the January 22nd, 2013 regular meeting and the February 19th, 2013 work session.
To be clear, was that a motion to adopt as written?
As written.
And was it a second on that motion?
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries 4-1.
I'm going to vote.
Any opposition? One opposed. And that covers both, correct?
I believe you read both in the motion.
I restated as
and
written.
Then, thank you, yes.
So that covers both. Thank you. Next are announcements. Are there any?
I've got a question. Since everybody's seen the minutes, and I forgot exactly what was in them, did we elect a secretary, a new secretary at the last work session on the 19th?
From what I remember, we nominated a secretary. But I do not think
we voted.
That we voted on the nomination.
No, there's no such thing according to Robert's rules of order of voting on the
I understand that and agree with that, but the procedure of the county, the sheet that you were given on last Tuesday night, that was the procedure that we elected nominations.
When you vote, that's the election.
That's not what the procedure sheet said. Is that correct?
But Robert's Rules of Order say that you don't vote on a nomination. That when you vote, that is the election of the nomination. And my question is, did we elect a secretary, did we elect a secretary? It's a simple question.
I think the attorney needs to answer that question, because that's been my question all week.
Okay, my question is simple. Did we elect a secretary at our last planning commission work session?
My understanding, having I believe seen the minutes that were adopted, was that the minutes reflect a nomination, and the minutes do not reflect an election. That being said, I also note that this council has not adopted Robert's Rules of Order as its procedures. It's adopted in the bylaws, the procedures that do exist.
I guess I got one more question. If we voted 4-0 for a person, secretary, where does it say that that would not be valid? That if you vote to elect a secretary, and we're not going by Robert's Rules of Order, where does it say? I mean,
the minutes that were just adopted reflect a motion and a vote on a nomination.
A vote. And when you have a vote, you can't. Where does it say that we vote on a nomination? Is my question.
It's common sense, because the motion included the word nomination. That's why it was a nomination and not an election. It's common sense. There's no law I can point to show you that.
So Robert's Rules doesn't have common sense, because Robert's Rules explicitly says you don't vote on a nomination.
We follow the same rules that the Board of Commissioners follows for?
Yes.
Actually, no, this Planning Commission has, and there are some rules incumbent. You have adopted procedures aside from the public hearing requirements in Chapter 8, which are adopted in the bylaws specifically. Other than that, you have adopted your own set of bylaws. They were last adopted, I believe, in January of last year.
But the procedure for voting goes as you nominate, you get a second, you close the nominations, you get
where
a second.
Where is that procedure?
All I can do is the minutes reflect that it was a nomination.
Yes.
But where is the procedure in the bylaws that we do that?
The bylaws do not address that specific procedure either way.
That's right.
Insofar as the motion the minutes reflect a motion to nominate and a vote on that motion, that is the reflection of this board's
and
this commission's actions.
And Robert's Rules of Order
does
not make common sense.
As far as
voting on a nomination.
I understand that.
I hear it. I was under the impression we elected a secretary with a 4-0 vote, but evidently there's something funny going on.
What I say is the minutes were adopted reflecting the action of the council at that work session.
Well, Jody,
thank you.
We went exactly by what the county gave us last week. And that's as far as we got. Motion by Pam Bowman to nominate Craig Nolan as secretary. That's as far as we got. We voted on that nomination. That was it.
And we also voted, I nominated you for chairman.
Motion by Joe Moses to nominate Pam L. as chairman.
Uh-huh.
Seconded by Craig. Vote in favor for the nomination.
And that tied.
Nomination. 2-2.
You don't vote on a nomination.
This came from our staff, and this is what our procedure we had to follow.
I'm not going to argue anymore for the sake of argument.
Well, I'm just saying, that's why it was done the way
y'all
it was
go
done.
Y'all go on and make up your rules as you go.
These are not my rules.
I mean, I would know that that's consistent with the way the Board of Commissioners did their elections this last time. They did.
Yes.
They had a motion, they closed nominations, everybody voted to close nominations, and then they made a motion.
Any other questions? Any other announcements? Number five, old business, there is none. Number six, new business. Number one, public hearing for proposed changes to the Unified Development Code, A, rezoning process, and then B, will be vested rights changes.
Good evening, Commission. I will present the UDC changes. I'll go with rezoning first. I'll provide a general overview of the changes, and of course, if you have any specific questions on any of the details, we can go through the actual draft. The changes to the rezoning process really were, it was an outgrowth of conversations we had with a stakeholder group that involved developers and a community group, and it was really looking at how to improve the process by both A, streamlining the process, as well as allowing some more flexibility to it. So one of the major changes was that we currently have a two application system. We have actually collapsed that into one application for a rezoning or a CUP or a HOP. In addition, we have streamlined the reporting requirements for the public participation report. In terms of the posting of the public hearing sign, currently it is a 21-day requirement prior to the public hearing. We have collapsed that to a 15-day period to coincide with the legal app. We have also allowed some flexibility with major application changes. Today, if an applicant has a major change, they get kicked back to step one, which is to return to preliminary zoning review and to start the process again. With the changes that you have before you tonight, there will be discretion as to, depending on the nature of the change, if they need to go back to preliminary zoning review or if they can amend and continue to be considered and scheduled for board consideration. And the final major change in the draft is that we have deleted the maximum number of residential rezoning requests that we can handle in a month. Currently, it is capped at 7, and we have struck that from the UDC draft. So these changes, once again, are to streamline the process while minimizing a reduction or elimination of standards. We will, depending on how the draft moves forward, we will have to amend the flow chart, which is figure 8.1 in the chapter, based on what the Planning Commission recommends. Are there any questions?
I've got a couple of questions. Section 8.5.4. The large C public participation report. Can you explain that? What that means, the change you're making, what you would like to see?
Well, the change before you tonight does streamline the report itself. So there are some parts to the report that would be eliminated. We have also changed the timing of the report as far as when it has to be submitted. Since we've gone down to a one instead of a two application step process, we are in this draft currently allowing more time for the applicant to get that report in.
So is 1 week satisfactory with the planning department?
Right now, it currently says that the report may be submitted at least 1 week prior to the Planning Commission work session. That is certainly something that we can comply with, but But of course, if there are significant changes at that time, it could, you know, create a postponement or delay of the application moving forward. That really is up to the applicant.
So I hear you saying that in one way, it may be that the 1 week, that may should be worded that in certain circumstances, the 1 week could be extended. That would cut down on a postponement.
Well, currently what the process is that they have to submit it by the deadline for the second application, which means an applicant has approximately 3 to 4 days to, after the public participation meeting, to compile a report and meet the deadline.
So we could change that to the report should be submitted at least 1 week prior to the Planning Commission, but could be extended, but the time could be extended at the discretion of the planning director.
We could
that,
not.
Would that help the developers a little bit with?
We could not. We realistically could not extend it beyond 1 week prior to the work session because we could not comment on any applicant requested zoning conditions. We do need at least a week to make comments to any revised applicant requested conditions. So that what we have put in the draft would be the latest we could actually accept a report. We could certainly back it up.
Okay.
Right now we're going from the 3 to 4 days.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Well, maybe how would you word that?
I'm a little unclear about what your objective is.
To give you more time so that you don't have to postpone. The idea behind all of this is to make it more streamlined. And if you're postponing something, it's less streamlined. And I heard you say that there's a possibility it could get postponed. So what could we do to lessen the possibility of a postponement, which would help the process?
I would say two options. One would be to basically pull it back in line to what it would be today, even though we have, in this draft, we've eradicated that second application. We can still make the public participation report due by the, even though we don't have a second application, we still have a deadline for board consideration. Meaning you have to make sure that the application is complete before the Planning Commission would review it and make a recommendation. So we could, in essence, mirror what is in the current UDC, which once again will give an applicant approximately 3 to 4 days to pull that report together and then submit it. I would say the latest we could, if you wanted to play with that date, would be the date the ad goes out. But even then, that doesn't give Teresa a lot of time to know, are we pulling things from the ad or not. So really, the draft before you, I would say, certainly accommodates the applicant. It gives them more time. If the Planning Commission would like to ponder that time period, we could retain the current timeline, and the way it would be reworded would be, and this is on page 8 of your draft under public participation report, C. The first strike that says the report shall be submitted, and then you see with the application for board consideration. Once again, we'll no longer have that application for board consideration, but what it could say is the report shall be submitted by the deadline for board consideration. Once again, we still have a deadline, but there's not a little application that an applicant has to fill out now. That's not too confusing. That would keep the current schedule as it is today. And what I will throw out there is, of course, we're lessening the requirements for the public participation report. So an applicant has to submit less items in the report. if this draft moves forward as is.
And we're not voting on this tonight. This is just a public hearing with a...
It's a public hearing, but the Planning Commission is being requested to make some form of recommendation so we can go forward to the Board of Commissioners in April.
We usually get the information to review 1 week in advance of that work session, don't we?
Actually, you get it well before that. It's in with your books. The way it works now is because the applicant has to turn around and submit that report by the board consideration deadline. That report and all the information from that is in your books, so you get it. It would be backing this up 2 to 3 weeks prior. That a week before your work session, your books have already been printed. That means if the applicant's making any changes, they're not going to be in your books.
We'll hear about that at the work session.
You would hear about that at the work session. That's the way the draft is currently right now. Now, again, that could lead potentially to postponements, depending on the nature of the change. This is really something that I think the Planning Commission has to, you know, consider and weigh and think about is the timing.
So it would be appropriate to make a motion to postpone the decision on this particular park. That might help.
Well, the draft is certainly up to the Planning Commission to decide as a board what you would like to do this evening. We have a minimum requirement of 2 public hearings, and that second public hearing would be before the Board of Commissioners. Right now, we're tentatively scheduled to do that in April, and that's tentative.
Any other questions?
Is it just timing wise? I was trying to think if it's received 1 week prior, we would have a chance to look at it maybe a week prior, but that means that in the 7-day period, you have to, the staff has to review that, get the comments back. The owner has to make a decision on which comments. I mean, like, all the staff comments don't really come until after that, correct?
That is correct. And I will say this draft really is, you know, of course, it's a result of multiple inputs. And so you are absolutely right, though. There is a fairly limited amount of time that staff would have to rework any type of technical comments.
I just want to make sure we don't get to the point that we end up, you know, people feel like that they're able to get things in, and then they find that we start rolling things and holding them until the next month.
Sure, and as I said, we can keep to the same type of schedule, again, keeping that report due at the board consideration deadline.
The deadline for
which is the way it works right now.
But it will also give the developers a longer period of time to work out those conditions, especially with adjacent property owners that were not working them out all the way to the meeting.
Yes,
they will actually be reviewed, which now a lot of times we bring them here, or the developer does, and they haven't been sanctioned by staff at that time. So that
Alan,
happens quite often.
So, Alan, what is your pleasure on this one particular item?
I'm okay with this time frame. I'm a little concerned just about, you know, somebody getting the wrong impression and we end up creating a delay for people because there's not enough time, especially if staff doesn't have enough time, because I know sometimes whenever you're dealing with those conditions, going back and forth with staff and an owner takes some time too.
So do you want to address that, or do you want to leave it like it is?
Well, it really puts it at the developer's risk if they're waiting until the very end. Or whoever the landowner is, this
I have line.
But also, Alan, they have between our board session and the Board of Commissioners' decision. So they actually do have a longer period of time to work, you know, with any final touches to everything.
Yeah, that's true.
I know personally in my district, we've gotten the time limit. I come here quite often, or the developer does, with last minute conditions that have been agreed upon between adjacent property owners, with owners, that type of thing. and staff has not, staff will not look, I mean, that's part of our rules now. They won't look at them after the deadline. This gives the extra week that they will look at them, and then we can address them at the, we still have time at the work session to ask questions, correct?
Yes.
Yeah.
So is your pleasure to leave it like they have it written here?
Yeah. Okay. It had been 2 weeks prior, correct?
Actually, it's back up 3 weeks.
Okay, three.
So we're going from a period of 3 to 4 day turnaround time for the applicant to 3 weeks.
I've got another comment on a different topic if we've exhausted this one.
Still with this? Go ahead. Still under the
okay.
process.
Section 854, part B2, small a, public participation letter. Y'all see where I am there?
Can you see the page?
I will give you the page number, but I don't see.
The page number is at the top right-hand corner.
88. 88, page 88. Public participation letter at the very top. It says, a copy of the letter to be sent to all persons, organizations per department procedures. The letter shall meet the requirements as set forth by the department, but the minimum shall include, this is letting the public know what to expect from an application. And it says the minimums are application number, application name, contact information, and so forth. My concern is the application name. A lot of times we get the application and the application name is a corporation. And sometimes those corporations actually don't even exist. I'm wondering if it's possible so that the neighbors, you know, because these letters go out to the neighbors and they'll see the corporation name there as the person that's going to be working on the property, but they don't know who it is. And I would like to see something in there where the corporate name as well as the personal name of the corporation owner or the CEO be there so that the neighbor would know who the corporation is.
I might have Tom weigh in on this. Currently, we do check the Secretary of State's website to ensure that the LLC is, you know, listed and is a viable corporation, but we do not list individual partners or members.
So what I'm trying to say is, why can't we let the public know, you know, who they are, rather than make the public have to go to the website to look it up? Why can't we have that part of the name?
There's no reason why we couldn't. If the information is available and the Planning Commission wants us to have it in the as a requirement, we could add it in.
Can.
Yes.
So I can make a motion to that effect to
yes.
open that up, be a little bit more transparent with it.
Yes.
I would like to make a motion.
Well, wait,
we haven't got the public hearing right now. Can we write it down? I can wait.
Did you have any other
questions? Let's see. I was also looking at moving down to the public participation report where it says, list of small a and then there's small b or small c. It it's a summary of attendee concerns.
What page is that, please? What page is that?
Oh, they're still on page 8A. It is, it's down there with minimum requirements. It's C1, small a, I, and C, where it says summary of attendee concerns per the meeting. That's one of the requirements to put in. I would like to see that read summary of all attendee concerns per meeting, rather than just a summary of the concerns. I would rather spell it out so that we see all of the concerns, not just what somebody decides to present before us. That's just another talking point. Anybody got anything on, any comment on that? Or?
I think that's what this says, though.
Huh?
Summary of attendee concerns per meeting, that would be all of the concerns.
No, that would be just the concerns that are given to us.
So are you talking about concerns other
I'm
than
I'm just saying put all in there so that we would have a better idea of all of the concerns. Summary of
so you'd like concerns. Attendees
just
stricken.
Huh?
You'd like attendees stricken and just say summary of all concerns per
No, meeting. No, I'd like to just add all in front of attendee. All attendee concerns rather than just, I mean, it's kind of like what Tom and I were talking about. It's almost like it's common sense to read it the way it is, but sometimes government doesn't act with common sense. And I'm trying to spell it out here so that the government doesn't have a choice to use common sense. They have to do all, so that everybody knows what's going on. It leads to more transparency in government. That's just, and once again, that's a concern that I have.
Okay. Any others?
And I apologize to the people that have zoning things here, but this is, to me, it's some serious business, and this is one of the things that I'm appointed to do. What's that mean? On page 8-11, down where it says posting requirements. That's putting up a sign, I guess. It says the sign shall be posted on the subject property at least 12 days prior to the date of the public participation meeting. And I'm sort of thinking that what if it came down on the 8th day? There's nothing there that says that it needs to be put back up. So I'm just saying that maybe we ought to put that the signs that we posted on the subject property at least 12 days prior to the date of the public participation meeting and maintain in place until the public participation process has completed. In other words, it lets the neighbors, I mean, you could put it up 12 days in advance and then it could disappear 11 days and the neighbors would be unaware that it's going on. Once again, that adds a little bit more transparency to what's going on in the government. Any Does anybody have a comment?
Who's going to be responsible for that?
The person that puts the sign up, that's normal to do this. You know, if they will put a sign up and they want to get what they want, they need to be responsible enough to make sure the sign stays up. And I think that's the way we do it with zonings and cups and other things like that. Basically, I'm not trying to make a hardship, I'm just trying to keep the public informed.
The hard thing with the signs too, the reality is some zonings, there are outsiders that continually take those signs down. So yes, I mean, the developer does need to make sure that the signs keep going up, but on many occasions, outsiders take signs down because they don't want people to see the property being zoned. Not developers, but the opposition.
And that's exactly what I'm trying to keep from happening, is I'm trying to get some transparency in government rather than hiding it, like you say they're trying to hide. You said people don't want them to see the sign, they want it hidden, so they throw it away. I'm not aware
not
of that.
Not the developers, the opposition.
That's what I said.
Yeah, people that don't want a zoning, they think if the sign goes away.
I understand that. But basically, just trying to keep the people that, you know, here informed. This is what's going on, and I haven't seen that, but I hate to hear that people do that kind of thing.
And they do. They burn them. They do all sorts of things.
The public hearing signs are actually issued by the county, correct?
That is correct. We're talking about a public participation sign, which is the applicant held meeting, not the public hearing meeting or sign.
The red sign.
I was just curious about, I was looking, can you simplify it? Because that one just says that, you know, pretty much the procedures of the, E2, it says that you would be required to obtain the sign. Is the signing and placing on the property in a time frame specified by department procedures. I didn't know if that was it, but there's one difference. A public participation sign is also not being provided by the county. So if someone continues to damage it, then that's requiring extra expense. I didn't know if the county usually pays to replace signs and maintain them.
We provide both signs. We provide the sign for the public hearing and the sign for the public participation meeting.
Okay.
And short of something extreme, which we do not experience, we do not charge for those.
Maybe since Alan is going to do a member on the board, he can be the person to ride around and check these signs.
I'm kidding.
But I do think that it's important that, well, that if we put signs up, that it'd stay up, you know. But if y'all don't want to do that, then that's fine. I can do, all I can do is bring it to our attention.
Do you have some others?
Yes. Does anybody else have anything? I don't want to stop anybody.
I think some of us are going to wait for the public.
Okay.
Hearing to hear any of the citizens have any input.
Well, I've got just one more here, and this is the last one. And it's just basically more a comment on page 1311. Talking about the residential zoning districts. And under Res 3, it's got 14,500 square feet for little Res 3.
We're on the second topic at this time. I haven't presented
it
yet.
Oh, we are.
Yeah, that's the best
okay.
of rights.
Have we finished up with the first topic?
If you're finished, I think no one else
I'm
is.
I'm finished with the first topic.
Up on to the second, the vested rights changes that affects Chapter 11 in regards to the Res 3 zoning district. You will see a table note to table 11.2 which states that RES 3 rezonings approved by the Board of Commissioners prior to November 1st, 2007 may comply with a 9,000 square foot lot size. And this is being stated because the minimum lot size was smaller at that time. So any applications that received approval that haven't moved forward, if they wish to come forward now, instead of complying with the 14.5, they could apply for the 9. We do have additional language, which is on your screen, that we need to add. In addition to the statement you see in the draft, we would like to add this statement as well. So it's applications not only approved by the board prior to November 1st, but those that were also submitted, because there is a time period that it could have been submitted under those regulations, but approved, let's say, in December or January. Also, the second part of these changes involve chapter 22, which is the last chapter of the UDC, and you will see one struck sentence. And that is pertaining to when there is an approval that they would have to comply with the codes and regulations at the time they come in for that approval. And I can answer any questions you might have on either of these issues.
Questions? I felt like I was on a roll there a minute ago, but I apologize for stealing your thunder. But I like the idea of the 14,500 square feet, which is 2.5 units per acre, rather than the 9,000, because that we have up there, because that will, if you go from 14,000 to 9,000, you go from 2.5 units per acre to what, 3 per acre, or?
Actually, the only issue here is the lot size, is that we would allow that smaller lot size. It's not affecting the other performance standards, so the density would be the same. Uh-huh. It would not exceed the density on the performance standards.
But it could possibly affect the homeowners that are near that particular piece of property. It might devalue their they may perceive it as devaluing their property in the process of trying to look after the existing homeowner, you know.
This only pertains to rezoning proposals that were approved by the board. So these rezoning proposals that this note would pertain to have already gone through the public process and were approved.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm just expressing basically an opinion that, you know, that's almost regressive rather than progressive as far as taking into consideration the value of the neighbor's property. I'm trying to take the homeowner into consideration, the neighbor homeowner.
So, but they already knew that it was zoned this when it was zoned.
What's wrong with making it better?
I don't.
But I mean, it's
different. But this is what it was zoned under. And that's all they're saying is they would be grandfathered.
I understand. And I'm saying we don't have to do that. You know, and I'm sure that if they were doing that next door to you or to me, I would prefer what I'm suggesting. But since it's going to be next door to somebody else, who cares?
Doesn't bother me either if it's done.
But I care. See, I care about what affects the existing homeowners here, if it's out there. But that's it. I don't need to argue the point. I'm just making a statement.
Any other comments?
But thank you.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing on both rezoning process and vested rights changes?
I move to open the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries.
Would anyone like to come forward and speak in favor of the changes?
Meeting, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, Ethan Underwood, the Livingston Johnson firm. I won't take up a lot of time, but I wanted to clarify some of the things that were coming up as far as or issues that were raised. With regard to the public participation report, what has to happen between the time the application is filed and the time that the staff knows that it's supposed to come to you, there's got to be some kind of trigger, some kind of a signal that says, okay, it's ready to go forward to public hearing. Right now, that's at board consideration. And what we have worked with the Chamber of Commerce and other development, people in the development community, is that it's burdensome, it's a lot of extra paperwork, staff's having to review that. So what we're proposing to substitute is the public participation report. That's your trigger. Now, let me give you an example of how we got here tonight and why we need some modifications to it. We had, for the applications that are being considered tonight, zoning applications, we had technical review on January the 2nd. Now, by the current code, we could not have a public participation meeting until, at the earliest, January 16th. Well, the deadline to file to get on tonight's agenda was January 18th, so we had 2 days. And that's typical. It's typical that you have 2 days between the time you met with the public and the time you decide whether or not you're ready to go forward. What this amendment would allow is 1 week prior to the Planning Commission's work session to come up. So that gives us an extra 2 to 3 weeks to work with neighbors. Now, if that's too long for staff, there's honestly, I could say you could move it back a week if you wanted to, because just playing with the calendar, again, if we said January 16th is the earliest we could have the meeting, then the deadline to file to get on tonight's agenda would have been February the 12th. So if you were to push it back to February the 5th, that gives us on the applicant side an extra week and a half, 2 weeks to work with neighbors. And that's what the purpose of this is we need to make sure that we're talking with neighbors and trying to address their concerns, and we have time to do that. But we also want to make sure that staff has time to review that. So there's some play in there. But what we're hopeful is that we'll get beyond this two-day timeline to try to move forward.
That's what I was trying. I'm trying to. I think you understood. What I was trying to help you out with that problem and come up with what.
There's a happy medium.
Yeah, where's the happy medium?
We'll leave that to your judgment. But I'm just telling you, there's room in the calendar to do that.
But you've also had issues where you've had zonings in the same district and trying to schedule meetings for two different. In fact, I know we had that issue.
For example, if you have two days to hold public participation meetings, and you have four meetings that you have to hold, really hard to handle that.
For this, especially the same area, same when the district. Same people
right.
want to go for both meetings.
So,
and that's what.
So thank you for considering that. And we appreciate staff working there. But there's the as I think Vanessa said, they have agreed to put it out as far as it can go. We can function.
So you're happy with the 7 days or a week? Should we call it 7 days or should we call it a week?
We could function 2 weeks prior to the work session.
What?
We could function 2 weeks. If we had turned the PPR 2 weeks
prior. But is that
prior,
burdensome on the staff?
It's an extra week for the staff, and it's one less week for us on our side of it. So maybe that's immediate. That's a suggestion.
Is the staff happy with that?
Yes.
With regard to
so and you're happy with that. So
what
would that change the wording to?
Respectfully, I don't want to eat up all the time for all the people who want to speak. So I want to get to my points quickly. Public participation signs. The applicants absolutely need to have a duty to have the sign to maintain it out there. But what we have encountered in the past is folks would. There was a gotcha in the code. We want to avoid putting another gotcha in the code where somebody comes up and says, aha, if I can get rid of this sign, now somebody calls the county and says, sign's gone, you postponed for a month. That's what was happening for a while. And for that reason, the county put in section 8-5.4 a statement, 854C, and this only deals with public hearing signs. It doesn't discuss the public meeting signs. But it says acts of vandalism or natural occurrences which may diminish the effectiveness of the public notice provided shall not void any proceedings or actions taken by any of the three boards or the director. We're fine with that. If you want to put an affirmative obligation to maintain a sign, you know, if it rains and gets knocked down, if somebody steals it, if the county calls up and says, hey, folks, your sign's gone, go put another one out, that's fine. We just don't want it to be something that blocks it and stops it for another month. And with respect, finally, with the 14,500 square foot lot, We're just asking as a matter of fairness, folks who have spent money, banks who have lent money, thinking that they have, for example, they think they got a 100 lot subdivision when it was zoned in 2007. It goes through all the economic shutdown, effectively. And now they come back and the bank says, well, we think we've got lots that we were collateralized with for 100 lots. And they go back to the stats and say, well, actually, the code's changed. Now you're going to put 60 out there. The value of their collateral has collapsed. And what we're hoping is just have a matter of fairness. Going forward, that's fine. We understand the rules are 14,500 square foot lots. For folks who spent money in reliance on that old code, we'd like to be able to use that old code.
My suggestion there on the posting requirements for the sign did not have any kind of penalty in it for anything. You know, it was just to try to keep it up there so we were right. When you do one thing and weigh in on the name, the corporation, will you give us a point of view from a developer's perspective on what I requested on that?
I'm not sure if it's necessary. We certainly published our name. Of course, I can only speak for my firm because we're forced to handle a lot of zoning work. We publish our name, people can get hold of us. As far as putting a name for an entity, if it's an entity that's not represented by a lawyer, they're putting a name on the application anyway. So they call us at this location. But there are some companies that benefit of an LLC is an anonymity.
So is the benefit is what?
Is anonymity in being an LLC. But they have a representative who you can speak to. As long as the public has someone who can tell them what the deal is, as long as you have a representative that stands up and says, I'm going to do this and delivers on that, that's what the public's looking for. I don't think that we need to get into corporate minutes and end up having to submit lists of 80 partners in the business, and everyone has to. It becomes a fishing expedition, Dr. Moses, and we don't want to allow that. We have clients to protect. We have interests they're protecting, and their privacy. Unfortunately, sometimes when people file unpopular zoning applications, they get harassed by folks. So it's better to have one point person who's the contact, and that's who's filed with the county.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Would anyone else like to speak in favor? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
I move to close the public hearing.
All in favor? Motion carries. Is there any discussion before motion?
Is this the time to?
Or would you like to make a motion? Are you going? Who would like to make a motion?
Okay, so this would be the point in time where if I felt like some of these changes ought to take place, I should make the motions. I've got several motions I'd like to make.
Put all your changes and suggestions in your motion.
I think I'd like to do it one at a time.
Well, are you going to do it for A first?
Well, I think there's like three years that I'm talking about,
if you can just put the motion under the ones that pertain to the rezoning process.
Okay.
Make a motion that you would suggest and your suggestions to the Board of County Commissioners.
Okay, I would like to make a motion that we recommend to the Board of Commissioners that on the public participation letter under the applicant's name, if it's a corporation, that the person who is actually the owner or the CEO, their name be displayed on the application. I would like to change C down here that we talked about from summary of all attendee concerns per meeting. I mean, from from just attendee concerns to all attendee concerns. And I would like to change the part here on the sign. I'd like to make a recommendation to the Board of Commission that the sign be posted on subject property at least 12 days prior to the date of the public participation meeting and be maintained in place until the public participation process is complete. That's my motion.
Did you also say you said something about the timing of the participation being turned in? I think you were talking,
I never got a clear answer of what people wanted to do, so if somebody else feels like that, if anybody else on the board feels like they want to address that, fine.
Okay, so
otherwise, I didn't make a motion on that because I didn't really get a clear response. And if somebody would like to give me a clear response, I don't mind making a motion. But I don't want to waste.
But you've already stated your motion. Do we have a motion? Do we have a second? Motion dies.
Okay.
Is there another motion?
I motion to send the proposed changes to the Unified Development Code on the rezoning process and the vested rights changes to the Board of Commissioners with a recommendation for approval as shown by staff in our PC books.
I'll second that.
Excuse me. I believe there was one item that was not in the books. Your motion mentioned the books, and the one item on the screen was different from what was in the books. Just to be clear, which you intended to include?
I did intend to include that. Do you want me to restate the motion?
Please.
I motion to send proposed changes to the Unified Development Code on the rezoning process and the vested rights changes and the Res 3 rezoning application changes that were shown on the screen. With a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners for approval as shown by staff in our books and on the screen.
I'd like to second that. All in favor? All decline? Motion carries. 4 in favor, 1 decline. Thank you. Number 7, public hearings for conditional use permits. 1, Pod Z Partners LLC, CP 120008, Commission District 5, Teresa.
This is a request to operate a senior housing independent living and assisted living facility on 8.79 acres of property. This currently zoned commercial business district, CPD. This property is located at the intersection of James Burgess Road and Roof Lane. And this application is consistent with the UDC.
Thank you, Teresa. Is there a motion to open the public hearing on Pod Z Partners LLC?
I move to open the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carried. Who would like to speak in favor of Pod Z Partners LLC?
Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Emory Lipscomb. I'm here on behalf of Pod Z Partners LLC. With me tonight is Chris Davis, who is the applicant. He represents the applicant in this request for a conditional use permit. This is for 8.79 acres of land on Ruth Lane and James Burgess Road there, just west of the Chattahoochee River on the west side of Georgia Highway 400. You've heard that the staff has found this to be consistent, and Mr. Davis and I'd be glad to answer any questions you may have. The plans to have 140 units. Part of these will be independent, and part of these will be for assisted living. Thank you very much. Glad to answer any questions.
Any questions from the board at this time? Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak in favor?
My name is Rita Sonner, and I'm one of the few residents on Booth Lane. First thing I'd like to say is I'm actually in favor of this proposed senior housing facility. I think it's a good use of property. Now, being a female, I stand yes, I like it, but there's already, even, let me back up, it's within 2,000 feet of the Chattahoochee River corridor, sort of under MRPA, as stated. Evidently, there have some kind of coattails on the Windermere project where this does not pertain. It said MRPA no on the application, and I question that. The Windermere LLC is dissolved, and Ponzi actually now does not have to do the stone facades, et cetera, et cetera. So they kind of divorced themselves from Windermere on the one hand, but they're riding coattails on the other. My main problem is stormwater. When they put in the Windermere development, the first time they did the storm sewers, the culvert tops blew off 20 feet in the air. The hydraulic engineer was in gas. It wasn't county permitted. When the county permitted the drainage basin for the septic, it's on the corner of Woodland and George Highway 20. That basin has never operated correctly, and there's now a 30 to 25 foot wide crude bass that is now exposed to pillars of the Georgia Highway 20 bridge. Anytime you have, there's a lot of steep slope, there's a lot of runoff. If you don't take care of the stormwater, you get massive erosion at the river. The Hot Seed sold land for two commercial projects that are along the 20, and there is a large drainage basin above ground exit. I don't know if it's not, it's a huge basin, but it does not seem to be impeding the flow of all this rain or any rain. Anytime we get a massive rain, it shoots right through that basin into the little wetland shown on Podsey's development and then straight across the road. And it's caused massive erosion down on James Creek. So my concern is that as the structure for Podsey shows, there's one underground catch basin on the west side of the parking lot. There's a lot of impervious surface. To make sure that whatever stormwater coming off is actually handled. The curbing that the county did along James Bridges has also exacerbated the runoff and the erosion. And so my neighbor, who doesn't live around, and we look over his property, has about another half acre of marsh since the curbing went in. And I think that the way, unless this project is handled correctly, it's going to exacerbate the water issues we already have. And I know the last heavy rain, we had James Burgess flooded. The second concern I have is that if you actually stand down, and I showed Chris and even the other lawyer, if you stand at Ruth Lane and watch the traffic, I would say 70% of the people coming down the steep grade from where the schools are that make the right-hand turn on the Ruth Lane do so into the oncoming lane, and they stay in that lane all the way up to where the proposed entrance is for this development on Ruth Lane. We haven't had a wreck yet because there's almost no traffic going north to south on Ruth Lane. My family has owned the Trout Farm property there for over 40 years, and we're really the only resident. So unless our traffic was coming down, there's very little traffic. But when you get into the afternoon rush, people will stand down there and look. I don't care if it's a bus, I don't care if it's law enforcement. No one makes that turn correctly. They stay in the wrong lane for 50 yards down that road. Part of it's exacerbated by the steep grade. Part of it, it can't all be bad driving because it's just too common. So I think before the housing development goes in, is the county needs to realign that road. Because if you've got an entrance coming off that property, that where the people are basically in the wrong lane, you're going to have an accident. So, you know, before it gets built, county needs to re-engineer that. And they actually have enough right-of-way. They've got 40-foot right-of-ways. We've got plenty of room to clean that up. So I think that's, like I say, I like the idea of the development. Two concerns are, one, make sure that they adequately handle the drainage, because we've already got drainage issues. And it could be partly that the big basin that's there simply has the drain open and it's not catching, because it just seems that you can just go down there and look at just a waterfall coming out of that anytime it rains. And that's supposedly part of the basin for this project. And so I would say that it needs a little looking at, and it will make it a better project.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak in favor? Would anyone like to speak in opposition?
If I understand Ms. Honker's issues, those are things I think the engineering department will deal with when plans are submitted for the development of the property. She expressed those concerns at the public participation meeting, and I think was generally pleased with plans and the preliminary plans, which are required as part of the application. And Chris Davis gave an explanation of what they intended to do there, and I'd be glad to get Mr. Davis to come up. But again, I think that's something that will be addressed in detail when the engineering plans are submitted to the county for actual development of the property.
Because no more water can leave this property than it does right now.
That's correct.
So I think you would be addressing the county on some issues too.
In accordance with the county's and the state's requirements, and will not create, more of a flow of water off of the property than exists before they start their development. This won't accelerate the rate of flow of the water off of the property. And as far as the traffic concern, I appreciate that Ms. Songer had pictures, which she had taken the day of our public participation meeting and maybe a few days before, which in fact showed cars as she was talking about making a right turn onto Ruth Lane off of James Ferguson. Cars were in the middle of the road, or maybe even a little further over the middle of the road. And of course, I'm sure the county the sheriff's office, and if it addresses itself to the engineering department, they'll be looking at that. I think we're fortunate here in that what we're dealing with is a very low amount of traffic being generated by an assisted living facility or an independent living facility. These people are typically in their 80s who live there. And I'm told by folks who operate these facilities that some of them bring cars, but soon after they're there, they don't use those vehicles. So this will be certainly low impact to the traffic in that area. Anything, can I answer any other questions?
Questions
from
anyone?
Anybody have questions?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any problems with any of the engineering comments or the recommendation of staff's zoning conditions? Do you have anything there that you disagree with him?
I don't believe so. Let me look back at them and make sure I'm familiar.
I
I believe there are two of them, am I correct in that? Two engineering condition, proposed engineering conditions. One, developer shall design and construct a left turn lane on James Burgess Road at the proposed entrance on James Burgess Road. And number two, developer shall construct improvements on James Burgess Road and Ruth Lane as required by Department of Engineering based on the final configuration of site plan. Is that what you're referring to?
Yeah, that's one of them. And then I'm referring to the stormwater considerations up here for the engineering comments.
Well, it says stormwater considerations, all developments must comply with ordinance 75, stormwater management ordinance 55,
yes,
flood damage.
Yes, no problem.
We understand we're obligated to follow
that. Okay. And then the part here where proposed request will not be scheduled for public hearing until Forsyth County Water and Sewer Division are well over the approval.
And they received that.
Any other questions?
Thank you, Henry.
Thank you, sir.
Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
I move to close the public hearing.
I'll second that. All in favor? Motion carries. Is there a motion?
Do I have a chance of getting a second on my motion? I'll try it. Okay. I'll give it a shot. I'd like to make a motion to recommend to the South County Board of Commission that they approve CP 120008 application for a senior housing, independent living, and assisted living facility on 8.79 acres of property, zone CBD, with a 16 unit per acre density, with the following conditions. The developer shall design and construct a left turn lane on James Burgess Road at the proposed property entrance location on James Burgess Road. Number two, the developer shall construct improvements on James Burgess Road and Ruth Lane as required by the Department of Engineering based on the final configuration of the site plan. That all developments must comply with Ordinance 75, Stormwater Management Ordinance 55, Flood Drainage Prevention, and make sure all relevant BMPs are properly installed and that the maintenance is carried out on a daily basis throughout the project.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Number eight, public hearings for home occupation permits. There are none. Number nine, public hearings for rezonings. Number one, James T. Kinney, ZA 3615, Commission District 5. Teresa?
This is a request to rezone 1.84 acres of Commercial Business District, CBD, and Neighborhood Shopping District, NS, to Commercial Business District, CBD, with a conditional use permit, the CBP, for pet boarding and outdoor facilities. He's requested a variance to reduce the side and rear yard setback and buffer 10 foot and to the sewer distance requirements in Chapter 18.5.18b. This property is located on the east side of Buford Highway, State Route 20, and it's 400 feet south of the intersection with Pruitt Road. Staff is supported.
Thank you, Teresa. Is there a motion to open public hearing on ZA 3615?
I move to open the public hearing on ZA 3615.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Who would like to speak in favor of James T. Kennedy?
Good My name is James D. Kenny. I'm the property owner and the developer. The request of zoning is necessary just to clean the property up. So the property has one zoning. It's a small parcel. It's 1.84 acres. It's got a zoning line down the middle, which is not necessary. One side's neighborhood shopping, one side's CBD. Conditional use permit is for outside use, I'm here to answer any questions or concerns anybody may have.
Any questions at this time? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak in favor? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
A motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Is there a motion from Commission District 5?
At the risk of y'all getting tired of hearing my voice, I'm going to make a motion. I would like to recommend for approval ZA 3615 to the Board of Commission. This application is for rezoning of 1.4 acres from CBD to neighborhood shopping, from CBD and neighborhood shopping to commercial business district only, with a conditional use permit for 6,000 square feet of building area with 17 parking spaces on a portion of the property for pet boarding with outdoor facilities. With the following conditions: planting trees to meet the tree density units required by Forsyth County's tree ordinance, parking lot trees and planting islands are required, frontage planting strip and trees required along the right of way, and recommend staff zoning conditions concerning the entrance to the property from Highway 20, and the applicant required variances in the application, which will expire 4 years from the date of approval.
Dr. Moses, for clarification, you're saying that the variances, your motion is, do you have the variances discontinue after 4 years?
Well, that's the applicant requested variances, and that's what he is requesting here. So he's trying to be sensitive. If you read, applicant requested variances, each one of those says, pursuant to the Unified Development Code, this variance will expire 4 years from the date of approval.
And that is part of your motion?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the last. The problem?
No.
You were just stating them as they are in the book, right?
I'm sorry.
You're stating them as they are written in the book.
Exactly.
Can stating things as the zoning condition in the book, I guess it just kind of holds that so that if there's ever a discrepancy in the future or if the code changes, you know, it could potentially bring up conflicts between what's zoned for that property and what the UDC states. And then those create issues for just trying to figure out what to do. That's the only concern I have about putting redundancies into each zoning case.
We've seen that come before, yes. We used to have a common one. We would the commission will sometimes condition a stream to 35-foot buffer. It was in the code. Today we require a 50-foot buffer. Every application out there that has a 35-foot buffer, there's always some extra discussion. is it best for 35, does it need to do 50? So yeah, that, I agree, that does come up at times.
I mean, it could become more stringent because it's decided that we need a more stringent code and somebody has a right at that point because this zoning ordinance is going to specify something that would conflict with that. So whether it's more restrictive or less restrictive, it just creates a potential conflict that makes it more difficult to change in the future. That's my concern about it.
So we have a motion. Do we have a second? That motion dies. Do you want to restate the motion?
I don't. I made no motion.
I'll make a motion to. I'll make a motion to approve approve as it is with the as the applicant requested, along with the variances and also with the conditions, the recommended conditions by staff that are shown on the screen.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor? All opposed? Abstained?
I'm going to sit this one out. I'm not going to vote.
Motion carries 4-1. Abstaining. Thank you. Number two, the Ryland Group Incorporated, ZA3616, Commission District 2. Teresa.
This is a request to rezone 13.591 acres from neighborhood shopping district in S and restricted industrial district in M1 to single family residential of Res 4. For 41 residential lots, this property is located in the northwestern corner of Shiloh Road East, Stony Point Road, and Shiloh Road. The application is supported as conditioned.
Thank you, Teresa. Is there a motion to open the public hearing for ZA3616?
A motion to open the public hearing on ZA3616.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Who would like to speak in favor of the Ryland Group Incorporated?
Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission, I'm Josh Scott, and Gibson Johnson here on behalf of Ryland Homes. As Ms. Cox said, we're seeking a rezoning tonight at 13.59 acres to the Res 4 zoning district. We're intending to combine this property with property located adjacent to it that Ryland already has purchased and is developing currently. You can see here the subject property is currently zoned NS and M1. The Res 3 just to the north there, Ryland has already purchased and is developing for 60 lots under the old Res 3 zoning category with a minimum 9,000 square foot lot size. That's the reason we're seeking a rezoning to Res 4 is to match this up lot size wise with the adjacent property. This will in effect be a phase 2 of this adjacent subdivision. We've agreed to a zoning condition imposing a 9,000 square foot minimum, so there's no risk that they will develop any lot smaller than 9,000 square feet. Combining these two properties into one subdivision is actually very advantageous, not only to Ryland, but also to the adjacent subdivisions. The most important advantage to the adjacent subdivisions is that Ryland can actually take all of the traffic from this new phase out through the old phase, as you can see here with the entrance going into the phase one, which is just to the north there. That way we don't have separate entrances on Stony Point Road and Shadow Road East, so we're taking potentially three entrances and making those into one. That will eliminate a lot of traffic concerns on Stony Point and Shiloh Road East. Secondly, it eliminates the possibility of an industrial use located next to a subdivision that currently exists, both to the north, which is directly behind it, you see the big green A1 lots, as well as Ryland's existing subdivision. We'll remove that incompatible land use and make that also houses. Finally, it allows the subdivision to be large enough so that Ryland can actually construct an active amenity. If both of these subdivisions were developed separately, they're not large enough to really justify and maintain a swim tennis community. But by combining the two, Ryland can put the active amenity swim tennis there. You see at the point of Shallow Road East and Shallow Road, that's where the amenity will be located. With that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you have, and I'll reserve the remainder of our time.
Excuse me, Madam Chairman. I've got a wife who had surgery this morning, and I'm the primary caregiver. If you don't mind, I'm going to excuse myself from the meeting so I can go home and take care of her. Thank you.
How many total lots will this bring us to?
I believe it's 102. The first phase is approved for 61 lots, and I think that may be actually developed to 60. This one we're seeking 41, so it's 101 or 102.
Will the developer be open to adding an additional tennis court?
I'm not sure if that's been evaluated. We can certainly look at it to see if it'll fit, but I'm not certain at this point.
Any other questions at this time?
Has there been any opposition?
We had a public participation meeting. Two couples came. They were actually property owners to the north in the A1. Well, let's keep turning off. The A1 section just to the north there. They had some concerns about actually the entrances out onto the roads. They were actually happy that we were taking all the traffic out to Shiloh. Other than that, I can't remember any other concerns. I believe that someone contacted the county, Ms. Cox can speak to this, about converting industrial use to residential, but I never heard personally from those individuals.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to speak in favor of ZA-3616? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Any other questions from the board? I'd like to make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries 4-1, not in attendance. District number 2, that is me. To recommend that we send a recommendation of approval to the Board of County Commissioners on the Ryland Group Incorporated ZA-3616 with the conditions as shown by staff on the screen. I would also like Ryland to evaluate the possibility of adding a third tennis court for this development. Third lighted tennis court for this development. And there are no variances, correct?
That's right.
Requested? That's my motion.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I think we need to be clear whether the third tennis court is a condition or
the discussion is my condition that they continue discussions with Ryland and the Board of County Commissioners.
Is that's to take place before the
Board of Commissioners, yes. Because I'm sensitive to the dilemma they may have with the available land to build that.
My only concern is that would take place before an actual vote, so the condition would not be relevant at the time that the Board of Commissioners voted on it.
They know that I would like to have a third lighted tennis court, and they know the reasons that I'm asking for that. So I guess I'm hoping the commissioners may hear me also and maybe be a little bit more forceful than I am. But I'm giving them the chance to come in front of the Board of County Commissioners with that already decided. That is my recommendation. Your second?
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries 4-1 on attendance. The next is number 3KM Homes LLC, zoning application 3617, Commission District 2. Teresa.
This is a request to rezone 2.019 acres from Commercial Business District CBD to Single Family Residential Rest 4 for 7 residential lots. There's a variance request to reduce the front yard setback 15 feet and to eliminate the exterior setback. Missouri UDC Chapter 1153, Table 112B. This property is located on the southwestern corner of Centennial Chase and Peachtree Parkway. The application is non-supported.
Thank you, Teresa. I'd like to make a motion to open the public hearing on ZA3617.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. Who would like to speak in favor of KM Homes LLC?
Good evening, Madam Chair. Members of the Planning Commission, Ethan Underwood on behalf of KM Homes. With me is Doug Straw, who is the Vice President of Development. He's here to answer any specific questions. But what we're asking is to rezone a piece of property that is currently zoned CBD. It has been for some time. Staff noted that they were not supportive of the application, primarily because we're asking to go from a commercial piece of property to a residential piece of property. But the difficulty lies in that we'll show on the aerial map. But what we're asked to do is convert this CBD tract to 7 residential lots to be added to an existing subdivision, Sentinel Chase. This shows the site plan, the aerial, the tax map, and the area that we are interested in is the property that's zoned CBD. It's been zoned CBD for some time. It is in front of a median that is not planned to have any type of access other than right in, right out. Because of that, that's affected its commercial usability. The original intent was to hope to get some shops, maybe some offices there. But our client has owned the property for some time, has marketed it for some time, and it has just, they've not got any leads. What that leads us to believe is its highest and best use is really to be added on as a rest for zoning with the rest of Sentinel Chase. Sentinel Chase is a 39 lot subdivision. This will add 7 lots to that, bring a total to 46. This is the site plan that's being requested. And with that, we have 2 variances that we've requested. One, and I'll flip back, the original the existing Sentinel Chase already has a 15-foot front yard setback. The Board of Commissioners approved that last year and granted variances, a blanket variance. We're asking to be able to match that so you have uniformity of locations. So we're asking for a 15-foot front yard setback. We're also asking for a variance. Whenever you have an exterior setback, just because of the technical aspects of the UDC, we actually have to be set back a good ways between the lots of the existing subdivision and the proposed set lots. So we're asking to eliminate the exterior setback only on the western boundary so that you have a fluid transition into the subdivision. Now, we met with several members of the community and what was requested. They said, well, could you provide one of these lots and make it an amenity area? Well, first off, that was not ever part of the proposal from KM, and it's not feasible either. For a couple of reasons. First, the lots are fairly small. So if you end up putting in additional, let's say you took one of those lots and made it an amenity area. Now you've got somebody's home that's right next to people who are out picnicking and making loud noises. So it doesn't really make sense to put it in the middle or even on the end because it's so close to Peachtree Parkway. In that regard, Peachtree Parkway overlay does apply to this, so there'll be, instead of a 10-foot landscape strip along the right of way, you can have a 25-foot landscape strip. So there will be additional open space or green space, but we believe that a An amenity area is one, it's not required by the code. We still don't trip the 50 lot threshold, even if you add these 7 lots and 2. It's either not safe if it's too close to 141 or it doesn't make sense being wedged in between these other homes.
Just so you can see what is out there, this is the view from 141, and there's a significant rise. So when the 25 foot landscape strip is planted, you're not really going to be able to see
anything behind there. You'll have tall trees, you'll have your overstory trees. And I think that's another good reason to say how this is going to flow with Peachtree Parkway. We anticipate there will be commercial development along there.
But this provides a good buffer, something similar you may see to this Long Lake subdivision on 141.
Very nice subdivision, great landscaping, and it flows and transitions well between the commercial and the residential.
These are the homes. They're very high quality homes, very attractive. And these will just be continued. You'll have more of these adding to the tax base and adding to the neighborhood.
So with that, we are happy to answer any questions, and we'll reserve the remainder for time.
Stephen, where does the bus pick up any students? Do they have to walk down?
I don't know the answer to that.
Doug, do you know the answer to that?
I don't know where the stop actually is.
There are some residents here that may be able to answer that question for you.
That would be a question if you come up here.
Sure.
Any questions from the board at this time?
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to speak in favor? Would anyone like to speak in opposition? Are you opposition, in favor, or are you in between? Do you have questions?
Favor.
Okay.
My name is Mahadev Tagador. I'm a current resident of Sentinel Chase as a second homeowner and then developed. For Sentinel Chase to expand, sell more homes, I will be very happy.
Let me ask you, have you filled out a sheet?
I did.
Okay, if you could just turn it in.
Okay.
Thank you.
We'll be very happy to have more homeowners in the community, and we think that is going to add more value and more space, kind of look and build and commercial activity. However, we also request to have a number of lots to be reduced to 6 instead of 7. The reason being is majority of the family right now stays in the community, have young children. We're going to Forsyth County Schools, and I think they deserve a common area for them to play. So 6 lot would be definitely beneficial if this case meant to be approved. So that's one of the things that we're recommending. And also one of the staff reports is that in Caribbean 2, initially it was meant to be 43, then it will reduce to 39 in the criteria M2, and that would make it 50 lots. That makes it mandatory of common space too. Even though the number of lots being reduced to 39, I think this case can be considered to have a common area for kids, primarily for them to play. And also, the majority of homeowners, we talk with each other, probably we may want to plan to go a community as a gated community, and if anything that would help not to reduce the outside, that would be beneficial. So if there is a provision from the developer.
So you would like it to be a gated community?
Yes, that's my general.
Do you know what happens when you become a gated community? You have to maintain your own roads.
Yes, ma'am. We do understand. We don't know much of the consequences. We are all first-time homeowners right there. I would say 99% of the country right now. So we have no idea. That is one of the thoughts that we did discuss. It may not be feasible, but that's probably if we all plan to go in the future, I think the road size what we think should not be reduced, kind of stuff. So, but our major concern is to have the number of lots to be reduced to 6, so we'll have a common area for our kids to play.
Yeah. I have a couple questions about that. The one is, where do the children in that neighborhood catch the bus? Does the bus come up the hill, or do they walk down to the bottom of the hill?
Yes, ma'am. I have a son. He is going to preschool, but and I have a daughter, 5.5 months. She'll be eventually. But I have a friend, my neighbor, Mr. Samir, have their daughter. He's already going to school. Probably he can answer that question.
Okay. And then I have another question for you also.
Sure, ma'am.
If you had a common area, either of you or your friends, are they the house that would be next to this? I think like lot number maybe 39, the first existing house.
Mine is lot nine, which is leading here, and any lot would be beneficial. Lot 39.
But what I'm saying is, the person that is in the existing house, the first house that's there.
Yes.
Would they have a problem with an amenity area next door to them?
Yeah, we did discuss with that, and he has children too, so he has no issues with that. We can probably support a letter regarding that. And he do understand that, you know, making a kid's area make it a little of a noisy area, but since he also has a in kids, he would understand. And
it would be like living next to the tennis court in some other
community. Exactly, so it's
community.
Yeah. So we're not asking for a common space for an elder or probably the tennis court or anything. It's just for the kids.
A meeting area.
Exactly, that would be great. And kind of stuff. So, thank you, I appreciate it.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to come and speak?
I'm for the phone.
If you go up here, they'll give, there's a form right there.
I have a form, but I haven't filled it.
Can you fill it out very quickly?
Good evening, ma'am. Yeah, my name is Sumir, and I was probably third owner in the subdivision. And we had a meeting regarding this. We are very pretty much new to this process, so bear with us if some mistake happens. So we had a meeting with the builder. They called us, and they were asking our concerns, and would you agree for this or not? And he said, we agree for this, because obviously we don't want a commercial at the entrance of a residential. So we said, but with these prerequisites, which my friend Mahadev mentioned just a few minutes back, to answer your specific question, bus doesn't come inside. We have to go all the way out on 141, which is very dangerous in the night, because bus comes around 6:30, it's dark.
Well, that was what I was getting to. Would it be better to have an amenity area right there at that first lot, and that could also be used for a bus stop?
Yeah, I mean, probably.
Because that could be a dual purpose. And yeah. I suspected that the county buses only came down since you don't have an in and out.
Yeah.
They only were there.
To be honest with you, we don't have any, we are not picky about it.
You just want a meeting place.
Exactly. We just want
to have picnics, to congregate,
for the neighbors to get together. Yeah, kids don't have any space, and most of the kids are in the age of 4 to 7, 8. I mean, and everybody's first-time homeowner buyer, and I mean, they want some area for the kids, okay, where they can go and play around and then find area kind of stuff.
So are you thinking a pavilion, or are you thinking a, it's the timer. Are you thinking a pavilion, or are you thinking a playground?
To be honest, I don't know the difference.
I'm just hearing out their playground, so I'm going to take that as a...
Okay, yeah. Because I don't know the difference between two, honestly. I mean, Google.
Well, playground is swings for the children. So that's your main issue, is you like to play with the children.
Exactly. That is the 10,000 feet level.
Okay. I have to cut you off because the time is over. Did you have any other issues that you did want to talk about? Or did that pretty much cover it?
My friend just mentioned the quality of the house. That is for something for us to decide, which is not this forum to speak for. Yeah, it's okay.
And you can continue between this meeting and the Board of County Commissioners meeting and talk with the builders, or with the attorneys and with the builder. It doesn't stop here.
Oh.
We are just a recommending board. We just make a recommendation, send it to your Board of County Commissioners. They make the decision.
Sure.
So you have this period of time to continue speaking with the applicant.
Oh.
So it doesn't stop here.
Oh, thanks, ma'am, for that. I appreciate it.
Thank
you. You all have a good day.
Would anyone else like to speak in opposition? We're out of time. Any questions from the board?
I do have some questions for engineering.
I'm sorry, but those were people talking in favor. You didn't ask for any opposition yet.
Well, I asked for either. I asked for opposition, favor. They were just in between. There wasn't anyone else that wanted to speak in opposition, correct? Because I asked for opposition, but they didn't want to come up for particularly that. If they were in between.
I did have just a couple of engineering questions. One of them was on the Sentinel Chase Way. I have the property next to it right now, zoned R1. In the future, it seems like it would be most likely with a future land use plan, that's going to be some sort of commercial. And Sentinel Chase Way is the only right-of-way outside of 141 that touches that. With the spacing right there, do you know if that's going to be the required access point for any commercial? My concern was, you've got residential driveways lined up. Is there going to be a commercial access that comes out into the middle of that residential area?
Without seeing something specific, I would be able to address that, especially the 141 being GDOT controlled and the spacing of driveways along there with the speed limit and everything. And it's a possibility that may occur, but without something specific, it would be hard to address that question.
Okay. I was saying GDOT, you know, GDOT is, it can't be landlocked, and GDOT is going to be very difficult to get another access point right there.
It would more than likely, if it was GDOT, be a right in, right out, because there's not going to be very many pretty median breaks there.
Right. Well, this is a right in, right out as well, so. I think that may be the only. Yeah, that's my only question.
Anyone else have any questions? I would like to make a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries. District 2, that's me. I'd like to send a recommendation of approval to the Board of County Commissioners on KM Home LLC, zoning application 3617, with the conditions as shown by staff. And I would also like to add the condition that a fenced playground area be added to this development, and that the developer gets together with the homeowners to decide the best of the two places that this would go, and that would either be at their first lot into 141, which would be lot 45, or lot 40. So that would be to be determined. And that is my motion.
Second.
And this is with variances also. We have a motion, we have a second. All in favor? All decline? Motion carries 3-1 declining and 1 not in attendance. I'd like to make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Motion carries 4-1 out of attendance. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Good night.